Thank you very much, Mr. President. Mr. President, before coming here, I did what some of us normally do every morning. I searched through internet to find out what happened this day in history. And look what I found. Exactly on this day, November 26, in 1939, the Soviet army orchestrated an incident by shelling a village of Mainila near the Soviet-Finnish border. Then the Soviets claimed the shelling was done by the Finnish side and used it as a pretext for the invasion on November the 30th. That's how the so-called Winter War started, which eventually led to the expulsion of the Soviet Union from the League of Nations. Interesting, isn't it? That is, so to say, about the unlearned lessons.
Mr. Polyansky was talking about who was learning lessons and who was not learning lessons.
We appreciate the convening of this briefing at the request of Ukraine. I would like to sincerely thank the members of the Security Council for their unwavering support of my country, demonstrated once again today. And of course, thank you, USG de Carlo, for your very useful update. We are convinced that it is of utmost importance to discuss the recent developments near the Kerch Strait, since they constitute a clear threat to international peace and security. Before delivering on the subject, I would like first to express my dismay at the attempt of the Russian Federation to manipulate the agenda of the Security Council and to have a meeting convened under a deceiving title, Violation of the Borders of the Russian Federation. In this regard, I have to emphasize that according to the international law, Crimea and respective territorial waters are the Ukrainian territory, temporarily occupied by the Russian Federation. Hence, there are no Russian borders in the area where the incident happened. I repeat, there are no state Russian borders around the Crimean Peninsula. Dear colleagues, you have already heard the Russian interpretation of the events, which, as usual, is concocted to mix reality with fiction with an ultimate goal of misinforming, misleading, and confusing the listener. Instead of real details of yesterday's incident, we heard epic stories about apocalypse in Ukraine. The Russian claims about violation of the Russian border by the Ukrainian naval ships is an outright lie, invested just to cynically shift all the responsibility on the Ukrainian side, consciously manipulating the facts and ignoring the evidence. Mr. President, for the better understanding of the situation by all Council members, I would like to present the main facts of what happened during the last 3 days. First of all, in accordance with the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea and Article 2 of the Treaty between Ukraine and the Russian Federation on Cooperation in the Use of the Azov Sea and the Kerch Strait, Ukrainian Navy enjoys full freedom of navigation in the Kerch Strait and the Sea of Azov, and therefore can pass through the Kerch Strait at any time. On 23rd November, the Ukrainian Navy boat group, small armored boats Nikopol and Berdyansk, and attack boat Yanikapu, started a planned transfer from the port of Odessa in the Black Sea to the port of Mariupol in the Azov Sea. The route and procedure of this passage were the same as in September this year, when two Ukrainian naval vessels, Donetsk and Korets, sailed from Odessa to Mariupol. On 24th November, during the naval march, the commander of the Ukrainian naval group received a notice from the Russian authorities concerning the closure of navigation in the Kerch Strait area. However, the International Center for Navigation Control, located in Spain, did not confirm this notification. On 25th November, the Ukrainian commander requested twice the Russian Maritime Control Services the passage through Kerch Strait. He did not receive any answer. Later, the Russian Maritime Control Officer directed the Ukrainian Navy boat group to the so-called area of waiting. It was stated that Ukrainian vessels would be soon informed on the Kerch Strait passage procedure. And then all hell broke loose. Approximately at 8:39 a.m., a Russian Coast Guard ship made a ram attack against a tugboat Yani Kapu and damaged it. The video of this attack is available online. If you watch it, you will clearly see that the Ukrainian boat was trying to avoid the collision while the Russian ship was deliberately carrying out the attack. I also have to warn you that if you happen to understand the Russian language, you will hear lots of profanities from the Russian sailors in that short video clip. After the ramming, the Russian vessels blocked the other two Ukrainian vessels from rendering assistance to a damaged vessel. All this time, the Russian vessels were trying to provoke Ukrainian seamen to open fire. At 1:22 p.m., two Russian K-52 Alligator attack helicopters approached the Ukrainian cutters at their anchorage spot at the height of 50 meters. They openly demonstrated their missile armaments and the laser aiming device. After completing the dangerous maneuvering, the helicopters departed towards the Crimean Peninsula. From 1:40 p.m., Russia has physically blocked the passage beneath the so-called Kerch Bridge, having located there a tanker and later a cargo ship. After 7 p.m., due to the impossibility to pass the strait, the Ukrainian Navy ships headed back to exit the Kerch Strait. I repeat, they headed back, away from the strait and towards the open sea. They were immediately followed by a group of about 10 Coast Guard and Russian Black Sea Fleet vessels. There are audio recordings of communications among the Russian vessel commanders regarding the orders on how to proceed. These recordings clearly demonstrate that the Russian military vessels were given orders to attack the Ukrainian vessels after the latter started to withdraw from the area. Approximately at 8:30 p.m., the Russian side carried out the shoot-to-kill order. I have all these recordings even in my telephone, but I will not waste your time, of course. I will just quote a couple of exchanges which were intercepted. There is a conversation between the base in Kerch and the Russian boat called Izumrud. Hands up, everyone on board, hands up. Surround your arms. We will shoot to kill. And then finally, well, who was carrying the shooting? It's from Izumrud. I cannot connect with Izumrud. There is a commotion in the air. They are shouting, the Ukrainians are sinking. And what is going on with Dell, I don't understand. And then the commander from Kerch is asking, who gave the order to shoot to kill? And the captain of Izumrud replies, it was me, according to your previous orders. So the vessels, the Ukrainian vessels, Berdyansk and Nikopol, were damaged. After the Ukrainian vessels were forced to stop and they were seized by the Russian FSB special forces. Six Ukrainian seamen are wounded, three of them seriously, and according to the previous information, one is in a critical situation. So once again, the video footage of ramming and shooting, as well as relevant audio recordings, have been already posted online, and everybody can consult them to see what happened and how it happened. Distinguished members of the Council, throughout all these events, the Ukrainian side acted strictly in line with international law and the existing bilateral agreement with the Russian Federation. Ukraine's right to cross the Kerch-Yenikal Canal is guaranteed by paragraph 1 of Article 2 of the Treaty between Ukraine and Russia on cooperation and use of the Sea of Azov and the Kerch Strait from 2003. The treaty clearly provides for the freedom of navigation for both civil and military vessels of Ukraine and Russia in the Sea of Azov and the Kerch Strait. Now, this is the treaty that was signed by the current Russian government.
Mr. Polyansky, you're not going to deny that this agreement has been signed by your side and needs to be upheld.
Secondly, the Russian Federation was duly and well in advance informed through traditional channels of communication about passing of the Ukrainian Navy's group through the Kerch Strait. Thirdly, the Ukrainian Navy group strictly followed the orders of the Traffic Control Service. As you can see, there were no provocations whatsoever from Ukraine's part. Nevertheless, the Russian Federation opted to purposefully block the passage of the Ukrainian ships, thus violating the freedom of navigation guaranteed by the Ukraine-Russia cooperation agreement in the Sea of Azov and the Kerch Strait. Moreover, Russia committed an act of an open military aggression against Ukraine by targeting, firing on, and capturing three military vessels. I would like to remind everyone that Article 3 of the General Assembly Resolution 3314 qualifies as an act of aggression, and I quote, an attack by the armed forces of a state on the land, sea, or air forces, or marine and air fleets of another state, end of quote. Russia's recent belligerent acts constitute yet another violation of international law, including the UN Charter, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, the Budapest Memorandum of 1994, as well as existing bilateral agreements. This is a conscious provocation aimed at aggravation of the security situation in the region with the aim to establish its full control over the Sea of Azov and the Kerch Strait. There is an irrefutable evidence that the recent Russian aggressive actions were planned and authorized by the top Russian military leadership. Mr. President, the restrained reaction of Ukraine clearly demonstrates that we are committed to solve the current situation by peaceful means and in full compliance with international law and existing bilateral obligations. Nevertheless, further escalation of the situation by the Russian Federation should not be ruled out. According to available intelligence data, there is a clear threat for invasion and seizing of Mariupol and Berdyansk. Further aggressive acts and provocations by the FSB Border Guard Service and Russian Navy remains a realistic possibility. Due to these threats, yesterday the President of Ukraine supported the initiative of the National Security and Defense Council to propose to the Parliament of Ukraine to declare the martial law for 60 days, but cut it short to 30 to avoid unnecessary speculations. This martial law can be lifted any time. It has no negative effect on respect for human rights and functioning of democratic institutions. In response to the Russian delegation's scare stories about alleged motives of Ukraine's president regarding the martial law, I will just quote the president's statement available online, the statement he made just a couple of minutes ago. The martial law will last 30 days and will be over in the middle of December. In early December, I will submit a draft decision of the parliament regarding the date of the presidential elections, which, according to the Constitution, are to be held on 31st March 2019. Full stop. Ukraine is ready to settle the situation through political and diplomatic means. At the same time, we are ready to use all available means in exercising our right to self-defense, as foreseen by Article 51 of the UN Charter. Mr. President, the Kremlin's criminal regime has once again demonstrated that it won't stop its aggressive policy and is ready for any acts of aggression against the Ukrainian state. The dramatic escalation of the situation in the region needs a prompt reaction from international community. These events are yet another testament to the relevance of the United Nations General Assembly draft resolution prepared by Ukraine and the group of like-minded states regarding the issue of militarization of Crimea and the Black and Azov Seas. Once again, we are grateful for today's strong statements in support of Ukraine, with the call upon the Russian Federation to guarantee the freedom of navigation in the region while condemning the Russian acts of aggression in the Black Sea and the Sea of Azov. Ukraine demands Russia to immediately release 23 captured Ukrainian soldiers and all three Ukrainian ships. We also call on the international community to implement a new set of sanctions aimed at addressing the situation in the region, including against the Russia's Azov ports. The increased political pressure on Moscow would contribute to the de-escalation of the security situation on the sea and unblocking the free crossing of the Kerch-Yenikal Canal. If unopposed, Kremlin regime will take another and another aggressive act, creating even wider conflict in the region. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the representative of Ukraine for his statement.